and welcome to the episode 6 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we're going to cover the most public fight between two Beatles and several little curiosities about them and the world in which they moved. On this date, in 1961, the Beatles performed at the St. John's Hall in Bootle, England, for £6.10, about £145 in 2020 money. The concert had been organized by Dave Forshaw, a 17-year-old music fan who was one of the two people managing to sneak into the Beatles' dressing room after their sensational Litterland show on the 27th of December 1960. The only other person managing to speak with the lads after the show was the night's host, Brian Kelly, of BK Productions. Forshaw booked the band for 3 dates at the St. John's Hall, each about a month apart from the other, easily recouping tonight's payment thanks to the great attendance. The Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, performed diligently and powerfully, as it was becoming usual. In 1962, the Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, performed an evening concert at the Cavern Club in Liverpool, sharing the bill with Pete Haslam's Collegians, a jazz group. It was an unusual combination, but apparently for a short spell, Ray McFall, owner of the Cavern and acting as the venue's music promoter, used to bill rock and roll bands with jazz combos. Soon, the jazz bands started to turn down offers from McFall, not wanting to play in front of a mixed audience of jazz aficionados and teenage rock and roll fans. This caused the Cavern Club to turn into a rock venue almost by accident. On the 6th of January 1963, the Beatles performed their final Scottish tour date with a night at the Beach Ballroom in Aberdeen, sharing the stage with the Johnny Scott Band show. The entry ticket cost 3 shillings, about £7.50 in 2020 money. The lads' performance received a mixed reaction from the crowd. Their repertoire, still mostly consisting of older rock and roll hits, was presented in an innovative fashion, with a personality different from that of most other bands, and some members of the audience booed them. The inadequate sound system of the venue might also have caused the band's sound to come off as generally lacking. For what turned out to be the only concert in Aberdeen of their career, the Beatles received £45, about £950 in 2020 money. On this date, in 1964, in the afternoon, the Beatles were interviewed in the London offices of Paris Match, a French magazine, for an article that would have appeared just before the beginning of their Paris residency later in the month. In the evening, the two performances of the 11th night of the Beatles Christmas Special went on as usual at the Astoria Cinema in London. After the second performance, the Fab Four rushed to the Talk of the Town, a cabaret venue on Cranbourne Street and Charing Cross Road, hoping to see Alma Cogan performing. Unfortunately, they arrived too late, and the singer had already left the stage. In 1965, another Beatles Christmas show saw the usual two performances at the Hammersmith Odeon Cinema in London, with the Beatles closing each and featuring twice in each show for comical sketches. On the 6th of January 1967, more overdubs were recorded for Penny Lane at the EMI Studios. Erasing all the work done on the song on the 4th of January, Paul McCartney recorded a bass track, Ringo Starr some drums, John Lennon a rhythm guitar part, and some congas. After a reduction mix onto Take 8 to free 2 tracks, further overdubs were made, with handclaps, pianos, and scat singing. A further reduction created Take 9, freeing another 2 tracks and completing the 7 p.m. to 1 a.m. session. The day also saw the release of The Family Way, the album of the soundtrack of the film with the same name, composed by Paul McCartney, with some help from George Martin. The work was done during the 1966 months after the Beatles stopped touring and decided to pursue individual interests for a while. Finally, on the 6th of January 1969, work resumed on the Get Back project, with the Beatles returning to the Twickenham Film Studios for the film rehearsals of the TV special. The band performed several arrangements of Don't Let Me Down, even a Latin-inspired version of it. Two of Us, at this stage still being a straight rock song, and several new songs like Harrison's Hear Me Lord and For Your Blue, McCartney's Carried That Weight, and Starr's Octopus's Garden. There was little interest in George's songs, not just Hear Me Lord, which saw solo performances on acoustic guitar and later on electric guitar with a wah-wah pedal, but also For All Things Must Pass and a song called Marine, which Harrison declared written by Bob Dylan, but that in most likelihood was self-penned. Overall, the working environment wasn't a happy one. There were a lot of discussions and fighting, especially an infamous bit between George Harrison and Paul McCartney that was included in the Let It Be film. In response to yet another exception by Paul about how to play a certain line for Two of Us, Paul thought it didn't fit. George acknowledged that, but said that he wanted to find a way to blend it with the rest. The two started a multi-take discussion, gradually getting more and more on each other's nerves. Finally, George utters the famous phrase, "Okay, well, I don't mind. I'll play whatever you want me to play, or I won't play at all if you don't want me to play. Whatever it is that will please you, I will do it." The final part of the dialogue starts 15 minutes 7 seconds into the Let It Be film, so if you own a copy, you can all judge for yourselves. But really, it seems that a bad situation is made much worse by the presence of the cameras. In fact, one could speculate that if the band had been working as had become customary since 1967, giving time to a song to evolve rather than being under time constraints, Paul reminds the others that they have just 12 days left during the conversation, as heard in the AB Road bootleg, this disagreement might have never happened. But since imagining alternative scenarios is not a productive use of our time, we'd better conclude today's episode. I will remind you to check www.simonmas.com/support to find ways to support this podcast, me, and my other music-related projects, and to check the description for a complete list of songs recorded during the Get Back sessions, as well as for an Amazon affiliate link to buy the sources I've used for the podcasts, should you be so inclined. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.